The hunger of AI is intense. Detail matters, granularity matters. As these AI systems come online, they need more information, not less. The appetite for information is exponentially growing. When Jess and I first had the idea for Global Objects, there was a really big hole in high-quality photorealistic content. Making things look completely photorealistic is a tough problem. It's really based on some artistry, some technology. So to try to do it at scale was something we were very interested in.
So Global Objects, we're digitizing the world. No small task to digitize the entire world. Every piece of data that we want to create is based on a truth set, is based on something in the real world.
And then that data set would be segmented. This is a bush, this is a tree.
As we think about AI, it's training on textual data, audio data, flat 2D data, video data. The real world of 3D objects is the next frontier.
And the idea of spatialness is really important, and it's going to be an important step in this next revolution of AI, because you need 3D to understand 3D. Like, we need to start teaching these machines and these models what an environment really is about, like what space is and how those relationships work. We don't really have a lot of good three-dimensional data sets to train these things on. You can't train a robot on things that have never really existed.
We want to be the purveyors of true, authentic object models, not just for applications in media and entertainment and storytelling, but in all other industry verticals.
With our workflow and the engine that is Microsoft and NVIDIA behind these tech stacks, we have reached the highest fidelity possible, because your eye cannot discern between a digital twin and the real thing in front of your face any longer. Talking to our tech partners, there was an interesting aspect of, you need to have a large subset. You need to have a large set of data of random things that you can then start to create that data set where you can generate off of. I was like, well, where am I going to have to go to every garage sale across the entire country to go buy just a random set of objects from all different time periods, from, you know, the 1800s up till 2025? And then, you know, I was like, well, Jess, you work in entertainment. Why don't you just go to a prop house?
So a prop house is the place where all the things, all the physical things that come in front of a camera to help tell the story come from. What we're doing here with Global Objects and scanning the library, we're onboarding our assets into the digital world for multiple different use cases. All of the things that were roadblocks for us as a non-tech company, they've really mastered.
Oh wow, a sarcophagus. This is awesome.
They needed stuff. We needed the infrastructure to get the stuff digital, and we kind of became the fuel to each other's rocket ships.
If I show you right here, for example, what we're essentially saying is, we're taking this entire warehouse. You can take it with you anywhere.
Anywhere.
Anywhere you want to go.
And not just one person. When off the shelf, it's not available.
That's right.
But in this model, 1,000 people in 1,000 different countries can all use it at the same time.
There are so many needs for digital twins. Obviously gaming, obviously media entertainment, robotics, medicine.
When you think about the opportunity to take a vast prop library and digitize that for utilization in any situation, whether that mean gaming applications, rendering inside of advertising opportunities, or social content creation, that is a huge use case, right? That is not just about storytelling and creativity, and you can bring it into any other vertical, you know, real estate, into retail and CPG, and the sky's really the limit when you think about real, authentic 3D objects that can then get modeled and deploy into different simulations and situations.
Our tech stack is very much procedurally driven. We're capturing at super high fidelity. Each object that we capture is thousands of pictures. We're scanning it with high precision lasers. And then we take that captured data and we process. It's intense. It's a lot of data. We're talking NVIDIA RTX A6000s at our desktop and the NVIDIA H100 GPUs on the Azure cloud. These GPUs handle the heavy lifting of processing and transforming large scan data into AI-ready digital assets. Work that simply isn't possible at this scale without accelerated computing. Being able to take the NVIDIA GPU architecture and the VMs with Azure and scale those on demand gives us a footing in the marketplace because we can now compete with some of the largest computational companies.
The most important thing, right, around all this is processing. The files, the size, the speed by which we're operating all requires the best systems, servers, operators, GPUs that are in the market today. We're at the very, very beginning of the AI era, where we're just starting to scratch the surface of what's possible. The relationship with Microsoft and NVIDIA is so powerful. It's not only for us learning internally on our own systems and operations, but when we're actually engaging with our clients, ensuring that we always have uptime, ensuring that we can always deliver with the most speed, efficiency, and fidelity as possible. And that's just such a huge opportunity for companies like ours to be able to punch above our weight. At the end of the day, AI is more around how do we enhance human operation than it is right around just being an AI gizmo.
We're working with another group that is training people on repairing these electric vehicles, right? Electric vehicles are now all over the place. One of the problems they're running into is there's not an infrastructure in place for the repair and maintenance of these things. So this was the bus scan. It's all one-to-one.
Right.
And it started to merge all the photographic data in. So Mike originally came to us because he was creating this PPE equipment, and he was trying to train people on how to look at the PPE equipment and know if the equipment was good. It started with a single glove. If this glove is ripped too much or there's too much damage to it, you could actually get electrocuted. And so he wanted to be able to show people that in a very highly, highly realistic way.
Because here they're mostly going to just interact with this.
So now we can create a realistic environment that the workers can move around the bus, start to do things in the sequence that they are supposed to do the procedures in, make sure that they're selecting the right PPE. The more virtual and interactive we can make these environments, it does cut down on that training time.
Time to enter virtual reality. The device allows you to sort of look through things and peel. This is incredible for training because you can look at parts, inspect them. And those are the types of things that you can't put into an instruction manual. You have to show somebody. You have to show them the thing at such resolution, at such a fidelity that it's imperceptible from the thing.
So I want to make sure that we have that highest fidelity so that there is no one that can come and say, no, that was not a true one-to-one, right? I want to understand the color. I want to understand the weight. I want to understand the material type. So we use a process of blue laser, photogrammetry, photometrics, and LIDAR.
All right, so we'll set up over here. We're here scanning the Sepulveda Dam. This is a pretty famous location. It's been in a ton of movies. We're starting with a LIDAR pass. So LIDAR is light detection and ranging. So it's a laser that spins on a head. And what it does is it sends out laser pulses and they come back. And it's very high resolution surface mapping. And it works 150 feet in every direction. Simultaneous to that, we're going to be launching a drone. And then we'll get coverage of the area, which we'll use for the color or texture data. We had an interesting use case where we were scanning in London, and we had to process this stuff really fast. So while we were scanning in London, we set up some infrastructure, and we were dumping data into our Azure blob and replicating that data over to here, to West US. To have an infrastructure where you're in a different place in the world and you can start to replicate your data literally across the globe, so you have teams working on different time zones and everything else, was pretty incredible.
A huge motivation for me to create Global Objects is preservation, cultural preservation, preservation of all kinds. Recently, Global Objects was brought into MOLA, the Museum of Latin American Art. And we were tasked with capturing a couple of their environments. And we came in and they had, you know, three different pieces of artwork in one particular room that we went in and digitized so that they can take what they have in a digital space and place our objects into those digital environments so people around the world could experience their art just as you would in their physical space.
So here you can see how she was working with the profiles, the eyes, the hair. What we're looking forward to exploring with Global Objects is the freedom of flowing through the space that we have with a digital gallery, but with the physicality of the exhibition that we have installed. High definition and digitization of these artworks works to preserve that and to make sure that if we need to go back to a conservation lab because something happened to an artwork, we have a realistic and a very well-documented visual reference for that conservator to work with. There's a lot of proactive stewardship. We take measures to make sure that the artwork, it's as good as it can be so that it can be preserved and it can extend the life of it. Because what I want ultimately is that in 50 years, when I'm dust somewhere, the art is still here and somebody can take advantage of it.
Anybody should be able to have photorealistic 3D, right? It's going to be so necessary in the future. This is absolutely going to be three-dimensional everything, right, all the time. I want to make what is a really hard problem into something that anybody can have access to.
When we think about the convergence of AI and AI-generated objects, I think the people, the human condition, really wants to understand authenticity. And if we can stay grounded in our pursuit to make sure things are as authentic and real as possible, then we can kind of harness that human connection, right, that the real world provides. And I think that that's a big component of what gets solved by what Global Objects is doing in the market with its technology pipeline and methodology.
What we're doing with creating these file sets is creating the foundation for AI. Creating the foundation of the real world to then generate and replicate moving forward. That's why the world needs Global Objects.
You know, the thing that I've always loved about movies is that it's make-believe for adults. It's pretend, right? So, and this is pretend, right? So we're on, you know, you think we're in a diner, but we're actually on a partial set with an LED volume that has scanned assets both inside of the set as props that are the same assets that we have here. You craft these sort of moments that are it's magic. It really is.